Welcome everybody. So today we'll be discussing around a passage of the Bible. It's from the books of 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 1 to 7. So I would read. A certain widow of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, "Your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that your servant feared the Lord. And the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slave." So Elisha said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house?" And she said, "Your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil." Then he said, "Go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors. Empty vessels, do not gather just a few. And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons. Then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones." So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it. Now it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said to her son, "Bring me another vessel." And he said to her, "There is not another vessel." So the oil ceased. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, "Go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons live on the rest." So I titled this reflection, "Empty Vessels and Open Hearts." This woman, I see myself in her. I just feel like we click on so many levels, because life dealt her some blows that really was not her fault, starting from the first verse of this chapter. But while her vessels were empty, she had an open heart. While she was broke and about to lose everything, she had an open heart and faith that things could be turned around. So the first thing I observed was that her predicament was not her fault. It wasn't. She wasn't the one owing money. It was the husband, who was a prophet, a man of God, that was owing money and died without pay. And even now died and left them in penury, in poverty. So this was, I don't know, maybe she tried her best to be the wife she could be, but the husband left her stranded. So the first point I got is that predicament will sometimes happen through no fault of yours. But the responsibility of getting yourself and those after you out lies squarely on your shoulders. You know that saying that life is 10% of what happens to us and 90% of what we make of it, really. It's a very, very true saying. She was in this predicament of abject poverty and really about to lose her sons, the generation to come, to slavery. She didn't keep quiet. She didn't keep quiet. Then she didn't do a blame game of, "I didn't cause this, so my husband caused this, so," and see what, you know all those stories we tell ourselves, "There was someone that got me into this situation, so he has to come and get me out." No. So I also don't know what predicament you have or you've been carrying for a while. The blame game never gets anybody to healing. It never gets anybody to victory. It never gets anybody to wholesomeness. It is knowing that, okay, now I have this issue on ground, even though I didn't cause it. But now I need to get better for my own sake, for the sake of my own future and the generations coming. If she had played a blame game, she would have lost her children and lost her own self. So first thing, predicaments has happened, and it will probably keep happening because they say life will keep happening. But me, I will choose my disposition and I will choose how I will act when they happen. And as many as I can prevent by prayers and by careful behaviors, I will prevent. But the ones that happen, God will use them as a means of miracle and as a means of lesson for me. So let's not be down when issues happen, when crises happen. God can use even the ones he did not cause. He can use it to promote you while the Egyptians were pursuing the Israelites, they were actually advancing them towards their purpose. If they had not chased them from the back, maybe they would have stayed longer. But while they were the one pursuing them at the back, God was pulling them into purpose. So what's the issue that is plaguing you today? It could be that God will use that same issue to pull you into purpose. Don't sit on it. Don't blame yourself. Don't carry a mopey face, feeling down. How did you get to this? And no, it is, what do we now do about it? And what did this woman do? The next thing she did was she took the issue to the person who could solve it. I want to believe that she had neighbors. I want to believe that she had friends. I want to believe that she probably had community people and all of those people. Those ones could not have solved that issue. She identified Elisha as the person who could, and that was the person she took the issue to. Now, many times, we ourselves do the same thing, thinking, if I tell this person, maybe they can. I'm not saying don't look for help, but even if I look for help in a human being, I know where my ultimate source is. It is God. He can pass it through a human being. So it wouldn't be right for me not to have even prayed to the God who can give that help, and I'm asking a human being. If I pray to God, he can order anybody, even my enemy, to be of help to me. But if I ask my man of God and I have not asked God to be of help, there's little that can come out of such. Influence, they say, is always vertical. If I'm going to influence you, it could be that I'm in a higher position to be of help to you. A young person who is unmarried and looking for lesson on how marriage will look like, we will not be picking such lessons from social media. We will not be picking such lessons from their friends who have married and their home is broken. You look for someone who can be of a bigger influence. A student who wants to do well, you look for someone who has done well. A professional who wants to do well, you look for someone who has done it well ahead of you. So influence is usually vertical. So if it's not from God, it is from someone who has done it ahead of you. So what issues, again, which is the same thing, what issues is plaguing us or plaguing you, as the case may be? Maybe you caused it or you didn't. That's not the issue. It has arrived. What do we do about it? Who is the person you have been taking this issue to and it has not been changing? Who are you taking it to now? In this case, which is God? That's the only person that can change it. Okay, then the third point I found was, of course, after she went to meet Elisha, Elisha said, what do you have in your house? You know, ordinarily we'll be expecting that Elisha should say, oh yeah, go and do this, go and buy that, come and collect this, and all of those things. Many times, when we take our issue to God, the answer is within us. It is Him that will pull it out. Like His wisdom gives clarity to what we never knew was there. If it's not within us, it's proximal to us. He will not send you to very far away to go and be looking for an answer. But it is knowing that the fullness of God resides in me. The Godhead resides in me. If I commit my ways to the Lord, the challenges, the issues I'm having, He will bring such answer out of me. And it's also in honoring the capability and the opportunities God has bestowed. Because she had a jar of oil. She said, I have nothing, only a jar of oil. And sometimes our own jar of oil too. We say, I have nothing. I don't have anything. I just have a husband. I don't have anything. I just have one child. Samuel was just one child. And he altered the course of things for God in the nation of Israel. David was just one child. And people say, I don't have anything. I just have one small shop. That small shop can feed nations if leveraged right, if given to God. I don't have anything, I just have a BSc certificate. That your single BSc certificate may be all that God needs to bring you into your next level of greatness. So what do you have that you're thinking, I don't have much, it's nothing. This is a reminder again, your little is all that you need. Your little plus God becomes expert. Every answer to every dilemma lies in you. But it is only the wisdom of God that can leverage that. And you would only access that wisdom by coming to the feet of the cross and presenting the issue and the challenge that plague you. And of course, when Elijah said, go and bring it, and people and borrow vessels and start pouring inside. Elijah said, borrow vessels from everywhere. from everywhere, from all your neighbors. Everywhere is everywhere. Everywhere is everywhere. What challenges are plaguing you? How well have you read the Bible concerning that? How well have you researched intellectual wisdom on the solution? Is it financial constraint? How many books on freedom, on financial freedom have you read? How many Bible verses on being financially free have you read? So when he says, go and borrow vessels, I may not have it yet, but I have faith that I will have it, and I will start getting prepared. If I'm trusting God for some levels of exploit, I need to start preparing myself spiritually, physically, mentally for that level, so that by the time it comes, I already have enough empty vessels for God to pour into. So borrow vessels. Don't just sit and wait that one miracle will drop. The principles of God, the miracles work by principles. God will not just drop it on our lap. If he drops it, it's still because there is still some work ahead that he knows we will do. So what vessels will you borrow today? Who will you borrow from? How are you going to improve yourself spiritually, physically, mentally, emotionally? You want to be the manager of a company, but you are an emotional wreck. It will not work. You need to improve yourself emotionally. You need to improve yourself mentally. You want to have a first class and you're just praying without reading. It doesn't work. Why? You combine the spiritual part. You also have to combine the intellectual part. You have to be in the books. You have to be in the lectures. You have to outsource resources even beyond what it was given to you in your lecture hall. It is only then you can say, yes, now I'm borrowing vessels. And of course, after the borrow vessels, what did they do? They shut the door and started pouring. Many times we have a lot of distraction that will hinder us from experiencing the fullness of what God wants to do in our life. Imagine if they had left that door open and one person has come, oh, mommy so and so, oh, so you're pouring a oil. Can I bring my own and collect a little? And oh, this, how did you get the oil? Who borrowed you that jerry can? You know, all of those things that distract. The same thing when God is calling us to a place of consecration, of being set apart with him, because there's greatness ahead of us. For some of us, as we listen to this, it's dropping in our spirit that God is calling us into some levels of consecration. It will require you to shut your doors and be set apart unto your God. And how do you do this? In your daily devotion. There should be that time in every believer's life where you shut your door, it's just you and your God. And the more times you can make for that, the better. There will be issues that you will not even discuss with anybody. It is you and God behind closed doors. It is only then we can access depth. It is only then we can get some levels of clarity and focus. So then, if you have borrowed vessels and God is saying pour, you pour behind closed doors. You pour with intentionality. You pour with focus. You pour with clarity, avoiding every form of distraction, staying put at the feet of Christ until all your vessels are full, until all the vessels are full. And of course, after pouring all the vessels, what did they do? He said they sold, paid their debts, and had so much to live on. And I want to believe from that they would have started a business that would have carried them into generations to come. But how did they start? It started with one woman who knew that life dealt her an unfair blow, but did not sit crying over spilled milk. She got her acts together and took the issue to the person who can solve it. So now, what blow has life dealt you? Is it issue of abuse as a child, childhood abuse, sexual abuse, physical abuse? Is it poverty? Is it divorce? Is it parental debt? Is it parental separation? You name it. Is it someone being laid off their work? As the case may be, what unfair blow has life dealt you? The truth is, it has happened. But the truth is, that's just 10% of the narrative. The remaining 90% is in your hands and in God's hands. So how do you want to write it? What do you want to do about it? Will you take it to God? Will you borrow vessels and shut your doors until the vessels are full and your narrative is rewritten? And as you rewrite it, the same way this woman rewrote her narrative, and her children were at risk of slavery, became free men, probably became businessmen and all whatnot. She chose to stand in the gap for herself and the generations to come. I firmly believe that every child of God, your life is not for you and you alone. You are a gap stander for you and for every generation to come. So every crisis that has come your way, you may not have caused it, but God can use it to leverage you into another level, into another dimension of opportunity and blessedness. So see such challenges as just an impetus for greatness and embrace it as such. Bring it to the feet of a master, the one who can change the issue. Borrow vessels, shut your doors, and ask your father to fill it. He will fill it to overflowing. He will fill it till you become a blessing to nations, till you become a blessing to generations. So until next time, I wish you well. If you know someone who would really benefit from this, please share with them. Share with them and subscribe so that if and when we post up something again, which I'm hoping will be as often as God gives me grace for, you can be the first to know. Until next time, have a wonderful, wonderful day. Bye.